Faithfulness required. A pianist by the name of Paderewski once said, "If I miss practice 3 days in a row, the audience will notice. If I miss practice 2 days in a row, my teacher will notice. If I miss practice 1 day, I will notice." And it's the same for our walks. There has to be a faithfulness to practice your walk daily. There must be a standard of faithfulness, of daily practice, of study, quiet time, and prayer to maintain your walk with God. You see, God gives you everything you need to lead a strong, successful Christian life. The Holy Spirit is in us. Jesus said, "It is a good thing that I leave you, because if I leave you, the Father will send the Comforter." And He dwells inside of us, teaching us, instructing us, pointing out things that we need to know for a strong, successful Christian life. The question is what are you doing with that power that God has given you? How are you using the Almighty God's power and the Holy Spirit that He has given you in glorifying and promoting kingdom business? There are 3 points of faithfulness that I want to go over today. And the first one is that you must recognize Jesus for who He is and the power that He has. Now, some of you may say, "Well, that's easy." But really, maybe not. Jesus is the maker of the heavens and the earth, the Alpha and the Omega, the sovereign God of the universe and Lord of all. The problem is that I don't think we give Him enough reverence. And let me prove my point by using Scripture. Go to Matthew chapter 8. Verses 5 through 13. And right now, I'm going to read all of those, and then we're going to take a look at some of the parts of it. Starting verse 5, it says, "When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, 'Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed in terrible agony. I will come and heal him,' he told him. 'Lord,' the centurion replied, 'I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be cured. For I too am a man under authority, having soldiers under my command. I say to this one, go, and he goes. I say to another, come, and he comes. I say to my slave, do this, and he does it.' Hearing this, Jesus was amazed and said to those following him, 'I assure you, I have not found anyone in Israel with so great a faith. I tell you that many will come from the east and west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.' Then Jesus told the centurion, 'Go, as you have believed, let it be done for you.' And his servant was cured that very moment." Let's take a look at verse 10. Hearing this, Jesus was amazed. If you underline in your Bible, underline, circle, mark it, or take note. And said to those following him, "I assure you, I have found no one in Israel with so great a faith." Think about it. I'm now in the process of learning new Bible study techniques, and they are enriching my life. And in the beginning of the year, we're going to pass those on to you that will come to the Bible study. But I used this Bible study technique in this verse here, and I was looking at the word amazed. And normally I would read over that and go on to a point, but that word stuck in my mind. So I began to research it. What does it take for the Son of God, the man who knows all men, the man who knows all hearts, what does it take for him to be amazed? Another word for amazed is that his mind is blown away. It's not the usual. It doesn't happen often. To be amazed, for your mind to be blown away, it can't be a normal everyday event, can it? If you're really amazed at something, it doesn't happen that often. So what was so amazing that blew Jesus' mind? Look at it. I assure you, I have found no one in Israel with so great a faith. The faith of this centurion that had in Jesus Christ amazed him. Why? Because he can't find it. And that goes to my point. My point is that when we come to the throne of God, we've got to recognize Jesus for who he is and the power that he has. And those folks in that day that was following Jesus wasn't showing it to them. And let me let you in on a little clue with this verse. Not even the disciples read it. Not even the 12 that he had chosen to serve him rated to be amazed, for him to be amazed. Just the centurion. There's only two times in Scripture that I have found that Jesus was amazed. One was at Israel's unbelief, and that's in Mark chapter 6, verse 6. Write that down because I want you to look that up later. Mark 6, 6. And the other time is in Matthew 8, 10. We're discussing it right now. That's it. That's all I could find when Jesus was amazed. Christians today, unfortunately, really doesn't recognize Jesus for who he is or the power that he has. And that in itself is the problem. We need to amaze our God. Our goal should be to amaze Jesus with our faith. To step out and do things because he tells us to do them. Not to ask for reasons or explanations, but just to do them like good soldiers, like the centurion experiences. If we did these things, if we did that, if we reached that goal, we would change this world. Amen?
Amen.
We would change this world because of the faith. But to do that, you must spend time with and serving Jesus to soak in the volume of his awesomeness. Have you ever done that? Have you ever just set off some time to spend with God in Scripture, holding his hand as you walk through the Garden of Eden like Adam and Eve, allowing the Holy Spirit to reveal wonderful truths to you? Last night, I took the dogs out, as I usually do. I looked up at the sky, and it was so clear. The stars were so bright. I told Lorna, I said, look at those bright stars. It amazed me. And that's just the awesomeness of God. Have you ever allowed Jesus just to soak in the awesomeness of his power in your life? Have you ever took time to do that? And if you have done it once, have you get hooked to do it every time? He is the Son of God, our awesome Savior, Master, Lord. There are a couple of other faithfulness examples that I don't want you to miss as I go on with this. Verses 7 and 8. I will come and heal him, he told him. That's Jesus talking to the centurion. Now listen, Lord, the centurion replied, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Why? Well, his faithfulness was there. We know that. Why would he not be worthy? Well, because in the teachings, the Jewish law banned Jews from entering Gentiles' homes. You'll find that in Acts chapter 10, verse 28. And the centurion didn't want him to break those laws that he was under, because the centurion was a Gentile. But you see the act of faithfulness? Jesus' faithfulness was to the Father. And it outweighed the laws of society. He went to places that they pointed their fingers at him for. They called him a drunkard. They asked him why he went to eat with publicans, tax collectors. We see it time and time again, because his faithfulness to the Father and his mission outweighed those laws of society. And look at verse 9. For I too am a man under authority, having soldiers under my command. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. The centurion, being a commander himself, submitted himself to Jesus' authority by his faithfulness. This was a man that was looked up to, who commanded troops, who got their respect. He was used to telling someone something to do and they would do it. No questions asked. He was the leader. They were the soldiers. They followed. And a man like that, sometimes in that kind of arena, draws so much pride that they're not willing to bend their knee. Not this one. This centurion knew who Jesus was. And he bent his knee to him. That takes faithfulness. It takes faithfulness to bend your knee to your Lord and Savior and give up the power of your life. Excuse me. The second point I want to make clear is that there is the power of faithfulness. Now stay with me. We see in Matthew 8:13 that the servant was healed from a distance. Jesus didn't have to go there. The centurion knew it. But why was Jesus willing to travel there? Because I think it strengthened this man's faith in his request. But the man, the centurion, said, I don't need that. I know who you are. And I know what you can do. Just say it. It'll be done. He was done from a distance. Matthew chapter 9, verse 29, the blind man was healed in person. You see, the power of faithfulness has no limitations. The power of faithfulness has no boundaries. The power of faithfulness will kick in hell's gates. Amen. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen. See, I don't like giving Satan credit for anything. I personally think he's a gnat against Almighty God. Amen. Now, he's something against us. But if we're willing by faithfulness to believe in our God, he's a gnat. A lost soul that has lost by our faithfulness. Hebrews 11:6 says, now without faith, it is impossible to please God. Now that makes sense. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. For the one who draws near to him must believe that he exists, and he rewards those who seek him. That's what faithfulness does. Faithfulness gives us the vehicle necessary to draw near to our God so that we can soak up his awesomeness. How many of you believe that Jesus is awesome? How many of you believe that he is all-powerful, all-knowing, all-seeing God? How many of you are willing to take time with him daily to experience that? We need to soak in his awesomeness. And we do that through Bible study. We do that through prayer. We do that through our quiet times. If you're not making time for God daily, change your routine. Enoch was one who pleased God by faith. We see his story. He pleased God as he went on a walk one day to be with God. He walked so far that God just took him on. He pleased him. It blew his mind. There's reward for living a Christian life. Now, let me make this clear. Salvation is a gift from God. Rewards is what we get when we are faithful in living that Christian life. You must live it 24/7. If you don't, here's what happens. If you don't live your life 24/7, if you're not faithful with maintaining your walk with Jesus and strengthening your drawing near to God, here's what happens. When the slightest wind blows of controversy, you turn into a foxhole Christian with shaky faith. You don't have the faith to get through the trials and tribulations that life is presenting to you. You don't know where to go or what to do. Doubt comes into your mind, and you don't understand what's going on. A strong faith in times of trouble is a great reward, isn't it? In itself, a strong faith in times of trouble is a great reward. As pastor, one of the occupational hazards, if you want to call it that, is that I get called to the emergency rooms, not usually in times of joy, but in times of sorrow, in times of anxiety. I get called to the labor rooms when there's troubles. I usually don't get called when it's a great experience and celebrate with the family. I'm not complaining, but I'm just telling you. I get called in the times of trouble. And I can see when faith is strong, and I can see when faith is not as strong. And I keep my walk as strong as I possibly can, because sometimes those folks need to lean on my faith. But I am no superhero. I have no cape on my back and no S on my chest. Everyone has the ability to have that faith. Everyone has the ability to call upon their God and be calm in the times of trouble. Everyone has the ability to allow bitterness to flee from their hearts if we're willing to have maintain our walk with faithfulness. Let's look at the third point. And this is one that you should probably know, but maybe you don't. You can't fake faith. You can't fake a strong walk. You can talk a good game for a little while, but I guarantee you, you cannot fake it.